It's very difficult to summarize all the steps of PCNL in 15 minutes. And at the same time, I must confess, the steps of PCNL are so variable and individualized that every eurosurgeon has his own preferences and idiosyncrasies. I will put it as idiosyncrasies because, like an idiot, we think that whatever we are doing or I am doing is the best and the only way. But that is not true. Interestingly, all sorts of steps are successful in experienced hands. So what I am going to discuss and what the learning objectives are, participants should be able to understand the logic behind steps of PCNL being followed by me. And if they are convinced, they should be able to reproduce these steps in their practice, which have been developed, adopted, and practiced by me over the last 34 years for delivering successful outcomes with minimum complications. I don't have any conflict of interest and I have nothing to declare. So as all of us know, the most important step of PCNL is initial puncture and making, please remember every sentence, every word, a short, straight track through the convex border of the kidney into a calyx, landing into the pelvic alveolar system in alignment with the infundibulum. So this is what, if you are able to achieve in the beginning, your PCNL is successful. Now, there are so many steps. Out of these steps, two steps I have deleted. I will not be deliberating more on these, dilatation of the tract and how to properly position the employed sheath. The other steps I will try to cover in a very rapid way so that I can complete the job assigned to me. Regarding ureteric catheterization, which is the first step, I will say that it is a must in each and every case, whether it is a redo, whether it is a relook, whether you already have a nephrostomy, because there are so many advantages of in situ ureteric catheter. It not only helps you in opacifying the pelvic alveolar system, it helps you to distend the pelvic alveolar system when you are placing the guide wire. Their space gets created between the stone and the pelvis, and you can place the guide wire safely. It also confirms the accurate puncture by obtaining the free flow. And it is the ureteric catheter which will prevent the migration of calculi in the ureter by mere presence of it. Even if some fragments, they go down, then you can flush those fragments back into the pelvic alveolar system by withdrawing the ureteric catheter and pushing the saline from below. At times, the PUJ is so much edematous, red, congested, that you are not able to identify the PUJ unless you have a ureteric catheter in situ. It helps in placement of DJ stents. And if there is a big mistake like avulsion or the big perforations at the pelvic alveolar system, it provides drainage in difficult situations. So therefore, I always try to, I'll always recommend that you must put a ureteric catheter and then take the patient for PCNL. As 80% of the world does prone PCNL and 90% of my cases are prone PCNL, I will be describing more about the prone PCNL. In prone PCNL, I put the bolsters like this in the vertical orientation, covering from lower chest to the iliac crest. I feel that this type of bolster gives a little counter resistance, counter pressure to the advancing needle. When the needle is going in and touching and puncturing the kidney, there will be some counter pressure will be provided by this. Otherwise, the kidney is such a mobile organ that if you position the bolsters like this, the kidney moves forward, and then they, all your angulation also increases. And I strongly feel that your track also becomes longer when you put the bolsters like this, which should not be there. Although there has been a study and it was published as Does Bolster Orientation Matter in Urology 2017. And it has clearly shown that by putting the bolster horizontally, it increases the kidney to diaphragm, kidney to 12th rib, and kidney to vertebral body distance. But at the same time, the study shows there was no statistically significant difference in the length of the tract whether bolsters are placed horizontally or vertically. But I feel when you put the bolsters horizontally, the track will be longer. Then I position the C-arm, and C-arm is always positioned by me with the 30 degree tilt towards me. The image intensifier is hitting my head. The reason being, when the patient is prone, supine, his kidneys are oriented like this, but as soon as the patient is turned prone, you see the kidneys are tilted at a 30 degree angle to the coronal plane. And these are our targets. This is the prone patient in front of me. This is the posterior calyx, and this is the anterior calyx, and these are my targets. And once you have a target, you should always see the target right in front. Therefore, you should position the C-arm with 30 degree tilt towards you so that the image intensifier is hitting your head, and at the same time, X-ray tube goes away from your genitals, which will maintain your fertility. Not only that, when you position the C-arm like this with the 30 degree tilt and you make a track like this, your puncture will be at the convex border of the kidney as compared to if you make the track with the C-arm in 0 degree, you will be puncturing this portion of the parenchyma. This may be 1 to 2 centimeter migration of your renal puncture in the renal parenchyma makes a great difference in the amount of bleeding. Why? Because when the renal artery enters the kidney, it divides into a major, bigger anterior renal segmental artery and a posterior segmental artery, which is a smaller artery. Both these arteries, they divide into many interlobar, intralobular artery. Ultimately, they make an arcuate artery like this. And from arcuate arteries, there will be small, thin vessels which are oriented vertically towards the convex border. And long back in 1901, Brodel had shown that there is a white line, which is an avascular line between this divide between the anterior and posterior segmental artery supplies. And if you bivalve the kidney at this level, or if you make a puncture for PCNL through Brodel's white line, there won't be any bleeding. That is the reason I always try to put the C-arm in 30 degree tilted towards me and try to enter the kidney through the convex border. Once the C-arm has been positioned, now there is a turn to put the contrast inside. Immediately, my first thing is to dilute the contrast 50-50, but at the same time, as the girth of the patient is different, and when the C-arm is tilted 30 degree, the main principle of contrast density is that contrast should be appearing less dense in comparison to the stone which you are going to deal with. So what you do is fill up the contrast in 20 ml syringe and put it near to there in the C-arm, in the same C-arm view, and compare the density of stone versus the contrast. If the contrast is still denser and more dark, you have to dilute it further so that when you put the contrast, the stone should not hide away. So after diluting the contrast, then you have to, only when you have already identified the stone with the tip of the needle, then you can allow the introduction of the contrast into the pelvic lesion system, because we have seen the stones moving on table just before positioning. And if the position, if the stone moves somewhere else and you make a track, a wrong track, you don't see the stone while making a track, that will be a mistake. Not only that, you should always use a very diluted contrast, because sometimes a over-enthusiastic assistant might have put the ureteric catheter or a guide wire across the ureteric catheter. Sometimes if the stone is completely filling at the PUJ, you might have done a submucosal tunneling, or if something, lot of fluid has been injected, there will be some vernitial rupture. So as soon as you put the first amount of contrast, there will be extravasation. And right at the beginning, your mood will get spoiled because there will be extravasation. So now you have a second chance. Now you put a higher concentration of contrast, and now you can see the pelvic lesion system in the diluted extravasated contrast, and again you can make a puncture. That is the principle of using contrast. I have never used air after 2002 as a contrast material, because in 2002, one of my patients, he developed hemiparesis, and it was very difficult to explain to a patient who has come for a stone removal and he goes with the hemiparesis. I was lucky. The air embolism lasted only for 2 days. Patient started recovering very fast. But anyway, now there are more than 25 case reports available, and air I will never use for as a contrast. I will always use the contrast material. Once the contrast has been injected, now there is a turn to put this. You have to design your track, and it should be a straight track in alignment with the infundibulum. So put the needle like this, but at the same time, needle should be positioned in alignment with the infundibulum through which you are going to go inside. You should never put a initial puncture in this way. If you have to make the calicial puncture, lower calicial puncture, either make a track like this or you choose this track, but never take a needle in an oblique way, because when you will be going inside your track, you will have to tear the adherent parenchyma here when you go inside, and there will be bleeding. So always position your needle in alignment with the infundibulum and then start putting the needle in. As soon as the needle goes in, you encounter the first resistance at the lumbodorsal fascia. You can still feel it. Go with the firmly little deep inside. Second resistance is felt at the tip of renal capsule. Again, you will have to increase your pressure and you will certainly go in. All this through when your needle is passing inside, you should always keep an eye on to the neighboring colonic gas shadow, and you should not try to puncture or injure the colonic gas shadow, and ultimately you will land into the calyx of your choice. In case you see when you are going in, and if the colonic gas shadow starts indenting like this, see it carefully, the colonic gas shadow is getting indented. Immediately withdraw your needle. Now take the more medial puncture on the skin and again go in. Now the colon will not come on your way. Even if you perforate just by one needle puncture into the colon, it doesn't matter, and you can just correct your ways and go inside. Now coming to the instruments which I use. First of all, initial puncture needle. Even today, my success rate is 1.6. Not every puncture of mine is 100% successful. My 0.6 punctures are useless. Earlier it used to be my 10th puncture used to be successful, and all the previous 9 were useless, unnecessary punctures. So all unnecessary punctures should be made with the thin needle, and therefore I choose a 3-part needle which has a longer, thinner needle which makes the first passage into the pelvic ilial system. And once we aspirate the fluid, and I am sure that this particular track I am going to use, this is my successful puncture, only then I thread in the thicker part of the needle, the 18 gauge needle, over this 21 gauge thin needle. And then when I reach my this outer needle reaches up to the tip, I withdraw the thin needle and pass the guide wire. So I always use a 3-part needle in place of 2-part needle, so that all my punctures, all my unnecessary punctures are thin punctures, and only the successful one which I have chosen, then for passing the guide wire, I'll take the thicker needle inside. Regarding guide wire, there are so many types of guide wires are available, and my choice has always been the stainless steel Teflon coated J-tip guide wire. Out of these, one thing, it is a very cheap guide wire and it has got a J-tip. It is not unusual, even the Terumo, sometimes when the patient reach to us and they really agree for going for surgery, there is a lot of pain and there is so much of edema inside that your guide wire can go out. And if you use a straight tip guide wire, many a times it will, the straight tip guide wire will pass through the submucosal tunnel. And if you dilate and make a track and passing double J-strand will be very difficult. So I always use a J-tip guide wire, because when the J-tip guide wire, as soon as it comes out of the needle tip, it acquires the shape of J. And then any further progress in the pelvic ilial system is with this convex border of the J-tip, and it is a very smooth progression inside, as you are seeing in this. It is going through the calyx, it is non-traumatic, it will hit the pelvic wall, it is bent, and then it will make its space. While a straight guide wire, straight tip guide wire, particularly the zebra guide wires, are likely to make submucosal tunnels and they can go out. Therefore, a J-tip guide wire I am using, and this it finds its path with its J-tip and soft semicircular part forward, thus minimizes the chances of false passage and perforation. Not only that, unlike zebra, which is zebra and terumo, they are good guide wires, but at that time they are very slippery and they tend to slip out when you need them most. Therefore, your half of the attention is always on placing and fixing the guide wire. With this J-tip guide wire, it is not so, and you can very easily do it. At times when you are puncturing and the stone is completely filling the pelvis calyx, it will be difficult to pass the guide wire inside and you encounter resistance. In these cases, what you have to do is ask the assistant to fill the pelvic ischial system, distend it nicely so the space gets created between the pelvic wall and the stone. And at the same time, you bend your needle downwards and then try to pass the guide wire. Maintain the needle tip here only, but bend the hub part of the guide wire, needle. And then when you pass guide wire, the guide wire will slide over the back of the stone and will go in. This is the trick how you pass guide wire when it is getting stuck because of the bulk of the stone. Coming to the puncturing techniques, there are three techniques which are very commonly used. In bullseye, it is very easy. You position the C-arm at 0 degree or 30 degree, then choose the target calyx, and now put the needle tip here and maintain the needle tip, needle hub, everything in the same straight line. Go in deep, 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 whether you are in 0 degree or in 30 degree. Maintain the needle tip and needle hub in the same line, like you go in deep, deep, deep. At one particular time, certainly you will go in, you will hit the target. But at the same time, remember, you will be hitting the medial portion of the renal parenchyma and it will cause more bloody. Similarly, all these bullseye technique, you will see the entering is at 90 degrees or 80 degrees from the skin. And the track is also like this, almost vertically oriented. And once you have a vertically oriented track, you have made entry into the pelvic ischial system. To for picking up this stone, you will have to bend it like this, and the fulcrum will be at the renal parenchyma. Again, it will cause bleeding. Therefore, I don't recommend this particular technique of bullseye puncture. A triangulation technique is just a mathematical bullseye technique. In that, you position the C-arm at 0 degree, then take a point here. This is the target point. Now position the C-arm in 30 degree and take a point B over here and measure the distance between A and B. Now, actually, you have created a right angle triangle over here with the 90 degree here, and this is the hypotenuse. And hypotenuse is always twice the length of AB. Hypotenuse is the line between the in front of the 90 degree angle. So what you have to do now is position the, after you have measured the distance between A and B, if it is 3 centimeter, now mark the needle as 6 centimeter, just the double of that. And with the C-arm in 30 degree, start entering from here exactly 6 centimeter, and you will enter the target calyx. So this is how it is. Actually, a triangulation technique is just the mathematical calculation to tell you how much deep you have to go. If your angle over here is not 30 degree, it is 45 degree, the length will be 1.4 times than the distance between A and B. So all these trigonometric calculations, they tell you how much depth you have to go in from point B, and you can enter into the system. I don't recommend this particular triangulation technique also. I always recommend to use a gradual descent technique where you are gradually descending through the convex border of the kidney inside through the white line. In this, you position the C-arm always at 30 degree, but don't start your point of entry here at the target. From the target, you make a lateral distance of 3 centimeter like this and make the skin puncture from here, and then start entering inside. Now you are gradually descending into the pelvic alicial system like a aeroplane run comes onto the runway slowly in a straight way in alignment with the infundibulum so that you can go up to the renal pelvis in a straight manner and you enter through the convex border with the minimum amount of bleeding. When you are following this technique, you are entering through the white line or through the convex border of the kidney and there will be least amount of bleeding in these cases. So when you are making a puncture, always puncture the most lateral calyx with the thinnest overlying parenchyma, which has a wide infundibulum to work through and is in direct alignment with the pelvis. But if you have an associated pelvic calculus like this, you should always puncture the stone-bearing calyx and go inside. Don't bother whether it is an anterior calyx or posterior calyx because there are two types of kidneys. There are Braudel type of kidneys, which
Dr.
are
commonly derived. Up a little bit.
Yeah, I will just finish with this only.
Thank you.
So when you are entering through the Braudel, when the, you are going through the Braudel's kidney, you have to puncture the posterior calyx. And when you are having a Hodgson kidney, you have to puncture the anterior calyx to go in. Don't bother about whether it is a posterior calyx or an anterior calyx. So I will stop short over here. There are techniques for maximum stone clearance, which I wanted to discuss, but with the time, I may not be able to discuss that. And I thank the audience as well as the organizers to have given me this opportunity. Thank you very much.